Welcome back to The Untold, and I'm really happy that we are going to have a radio host, Ahmed.
Yes, he has been doing it for a long time.
99.7.
He has a great, yes, 99.7.
You probably heard his voice.
I believe it's the most popular channel in Kuwait, I would say.
Like, radio you know? Station in English? Yeah, this yeah, is probably
very,
the most
very
popular. And if you probably wouldn't recognize his face, but you will recognize his
voice,
definitely.
From The Weekender, Noor Najdi will be joining us right next. We're back on the show welcoming our very special guest, perhaps a stranger television wise but not a stranger radio wise. Or have you done TV interviews?
I have done one interview with the TV in Hala, Kuwait.
Oh, nice. Okay, nice.
That
nice,
was
nice.
Definitely interesting to have an interview there.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our very special guest, KTV Zone, or should I say 99.7 Zone,
Noor Najdi.
Welcome on the show.
It's nice to have you on the show.
Pleasure's all mine.
The first thing I can tell, you can hear the tone of his voice.
It's radio voice.
Yeah, radio voice. I mean, you have that perfect tone for radio. So
appreciate
let's
that.
Begin with an introduction about yourself. Tell us who is Noor Najdi is.
How long ago did you start?
Just, I want to get to
just
know
the
you
brief.
Today.
Just a brief.
Okay.
Well, after graduation from college, if you want to start from there, I always had the idea of doing something with my voice because everywhere I go, I keep hearing the word, your voice. So great. What's the next step is one or two things. We have to, you know, financially be ready to go somewhere where I can actually broadcast and do this. Back then, and I'm not saying I'm old, but just back then, it was different because you need to know somebody and reach somebody in a radio station. In Egypt, it wasn't really that helpful. So I traveled to Dubai, and that's when I had my first opportunity to interact with Virgin Radio, or one of the radio stations in Dubai, basically. And I had the opportunity to use my voice as in advertising. And then
you have that voice for advertising.
Yeah,
you have that. Like
it was very weird because I most of the ads were basically watches, pens, ties, and cars.
Interesting ties.
How do you promote ties?
I have no idea how.
Maybe they have a sale going on.
Yeah, tie and you know, ghutra and
okay, nice,
stuff
nice.
Like that. Yes.
Is it? Do you think it's the how deep your voice is?
Not just
radio
how deep.
Goes for that deep voice, I guess.
The radio is a very challenging occupation. I'm not going to really call it a job.
Okay.
Because unfortunately nowadays a job is something that you have to do, or a lot of people think that they have to
True.
Do this. But this is basically a responsibility. When you're on the radio, you can't, people can't see you.
Right.
People can't know your reaction. People can't see what you're talking about unless you send the message.
So you have to use your voice to send
your
that
voice.
Message. That's what I was saying.
Yes.
Yeah, the voice is the only thing you can rely on in terms of radio.
Yeah, on TV you can use your face to express and, you know, you tell people, oh my God, this is happening. But on the radio, it doesn't matter what you do your face. You have to
It's like voice acting.
Sound.
Yeah. It's voice acting.
It basically is. And some people are just born with that talent. Some people need practice.
Have you tried voice acting?
Yes, I did. I do some voice acting for books. I do some voice actings for gaming.
Gaming?
Because, yes, I am a gamer.
Okay.
Yes. So I look like a grown man, but from inside, I'm actually a 10-year-old. So basically, I play a lot.
Real men play video games, okay?
Yes. Hey, when the apocalypse comes, the gamers are going to be the survivors.
You got to survive a zombie apocalypse?
Oh, yeah.
You
can't wait.
What is that related to gaming?
Because we know how to shoot zombies.
Only, yeah.
With a controller.
Backpack.
I watch zombie movies.
Knee pads.
Yeah, that works.
I know the basics of survival.
Okay.
You know,
canned food. Just stock up canned food.
Tuna, a lot of tuna.
All right, it's not The Walking Dead. We're back on The Untold. voice acting, video games. Are you voice acting in a video game?
Yes, I did voice acting for a couple of video games.
What video games?
Nothing fancy, nothing well-known.
Well, it's still fancy. It's a video game.
Yes, but I was basically asked to say a couple of sentences regarding opening areas and closing areas and use your voice in saying these words. And also use it to be the villain in one of the lines in the game. So this is how I do this as voice acting. But going back to your original question, as a job for radio, I tend to believe that I am doing something that I love and enjoy. And not everybody has that chance. It is really competitive because to the reason why I'm doing this is I want to make the person who is driving the car in the middle of the traffic in that heat of our country right now, he would listen to somebody. I know that he can just put on the song on a phone, but if he listened to me accidentally by once or a word of mouth spreads around and he listened to me, he will have a good time just for a little while. I want him to think that I'm sitting next to him. I'm his friend. I'm hanging out with you. We're just hanging out.
That's the beauty of
the I'm talking thing, to you. Yeah. And we are all in the radio station.
I love how you describe it.
We're different. Everyone as a talk show host is different than the other. Ma, she is the expert. She's been there for years and years and years and years. So when she presents on the radio show, her drive back in the afternoon, she's very professional. She has a British accent broadcaster. This is a whole different vibe. But for me, I want to talk to the common man who is working hard in this junk food joint and putting his earplug just to listen to me. And I want to send him a positive message. So I'm picking up on subjects on weekends, which is my show, that try to provide a message to whoever is listening, and at the same time to keep them attracted to what I'm talking about and integrated with me and interacting. How do they interact? They pick up the phone and they call. They give me a call.
So you mentioned something about, you know, people using their phones to listen to music. How does that affect, you know, radio stations? Because we used to get our music from radios, now we just use phones.
Now it's a whole different vibe from how it used to be back in the 80s and back in the 70s. Back in the 70s and the 80s, radios was everywhere, and even, I'm going to go further than that. World War One, World War Two, radio was the main to go to listen to know what's going on. All the way up to the late 90s, sure. Nowadays it's different. I can listen to any song I want. But let's be real here. In the Middle East where we are, it's not really easy to listen to English music or any kind of music without being careful of what you're listening to, because it doesn't really go custom hand in hand with
how we are. So saying when it's radio in our country, it's more, not censored, but filtered to deliver clean good
music. It is censored and filtered. I've heard some of the music on 99.7. They usually censor it, filter it, they alter it in more of a clean versions of...
Yes, yeah. We try to trim the song as much as we can to suit our audience and at the same time to suit our authorities and, you know, traditions and whatnot.
Now, it's just a quick question about this process. Does the music or the artist contribute to this censorship, let's call it? Do they know what's happening?
Have you heard
Because with movies, they have to approve. With music, do they have to approve?
Not really, because I heard it on the radio. They don't really change words or anything. They just blur them off. Or
we filter them and trim them. Basically, we either cover them up or just cut them out.
Make them blurry. So they sound
but that
blurry.
Means that there is a dedicated person listening to every single song in the library.
Wow.
To understand and cut off the necessary and how to trim it.
I think it's fun, though. Imagine your job listening to music and just...
Not if you're doing that for 35,000 songs.
35,000 songs. How fresh and new the music is on the radio?
From the Billboard charts, it's extremely fresh. Always we're bringing in the brightest, the newest Billboard chart songs, which is definitely my favorite genre of music. I'm lying. This is definitely not my vibe. I don't like this music at all. But
which is?
Which is the Billboard music.
Oh, okay. Do you Taylor mean the mainstream Swift, music you don't
yeah.
like?
Yeah, I don't like. Well, because I'm a boomer. And we tend to stick to our own style of music, if you will.
What is that?
Starting from, I don't know, from the...
Pop?
No. I'm going all the way back. I'm starting from Frank Sinatra, Dean Martin,
yeah.
going all the way
that's
to...
That's what I figured he would be.
Black Sabbath.
Classic.
Iron Maiden, Metallica. I'm going all the genres. Tupac, Biggie okay. Smalls. You know where I'm going with this?
But they've been on the
Classics.
Billboard.
Sure. For a minute. Take a look at Taylor Swift. She has 10 songs
Taylor
on the
Swift.
Billboard
everywhere.
Charts.
Everywhere.
That's an example. Kanye West goes
Come
on Billboard
Taylor
charts. Nicki Minaj goes on Billboard charts. Are they going for the Billboard charts for the song, or are you going for the video?
I don't really go for the video. I just go for the song. I barely see any music videos, honestly.
Right.
I honestly go for the lyrics. Honestly.
It depends on my mood, though. It depends on how I'm feeling at that time when I decide to listen to a song. I just look for a song that suits more my mood.
That is why you usually, back in the day, I'm going to take a quick example, Michael Jackson.
Okay.
Michael Jackson, back when he was young, right, he made his debut album, Thriller.
True.
And Thriller is the bestseller.
It's a hit. It was a hit.
Of all time.
True.
Up till this second as we speak. And that album was made in the 80s. The video
You're
clip...
You're saying that's the most selling album ever?
Ever.
Really?
Up till this second.
Huh.
Please check my information.
I
might be losing it.
Yeah.
But it's true. It's true as far as I remember. So, that video clip in the 80s, mind you, cost $6 million to create.
It's all for Mel Michael, I guess.
That's a lot of awful money for a video clip back in the 80s.
Oh, the budget for the music video, Thriller, was $6
million? Yes, sir. Give or take.
But when I watched it, it didn't seem like it needed that much money to be made. Or maybe back then it was different. I'm not sure.
You're
looking at it. $6 million back then, not now. So it's more.
And you're looking at it now, right?
Right.
Look at it from the 80s.
That's
now when
crazy
I look at
spending.
It, I'm like, I could have done this with you.
All right. So you're talking about what? Choreography,
makeup,
clothing, music.
Yeah, choreography
stage,
was basically
people.
That famous.
That was nothing, right? That was
that,
easy
that
to come
is,
up with, right?
That is up until this moment. So back then, it wasn't easy to become famous. The radio is your gateway or stairway to heaven, as.
Yeah, I know the song. Wait,
okay.
Who sang it?
Stairway to Heaven, hello?
Okay.
It's a very famous song for the guys out there.
Out there.
Okay.
But yeah, that was the only way to listen to. But the main thing is that they don't listen to the songs nowadays. They listen to us. So it's very important when you come to the radio, you even if you have a bad day, just like you guys do.
Yeah, you put a smile on your face. And
no, not really a smile.
I mean, that's what I do at my job. I have to put a smile on my face. But
I have to put a face on my face when I come to the stadium, to the studio, because I need to make sure that I am on this microphone to somebody else make his day better.
You check your issues at the door. You
leave them outside, just like I said.
You Come turn in into, you get into the zone. Basically.
And I do, by the way, clap, but not just like yours, because your clap is very awkward, actually. It's just like everybody's quiet and you're just like going clapping. But for me, I'd be like, yeah, let's go.
That's different.
You're not really used to TV. Anyway, let's take a quick break.
Yes, quick break.
And then we'll be right back.
All right. We're back on The Untold, continuing on our conversation with Noor Nejdi, our resident radio host here for 99.7. Have you done different channels as well?
No, I usually stick to one channel because I'm not a multitasker. Only women can multitask. But let me ask you a question.
Okay.
Regarding your work, how if you were in a different genre or a different age or different year, do you think you would have been much different in a lifestyle, or you would be exactly who you are if you were born in the 60s and you were presented by this opportunity?
Wow, back in the 60s and a television host?
Yes.
How would I have?
I think in Korea, you're probably wearing Dishdasha right now.
Yeah, probably.
And
I don't know. That's a very
fans are gonna be outside.
And we wouldn't be sitting right here. You'd probably be doing something really formal. Uh-huh. And that's what I would imagine.
I don't know. Back in the 60s,
I'm
what
sure
would I be doing?
I'm sure women were TV presenters back then.
Could you have been sitting right here and actually doing this?
I think, no. Did they even have podcasts back then?
No, they didn't have podcasts.
No, we didn't even have. Yeah, we did have television back then.
And did they even have women presenters?
We did have television.
That's the question. Like, would you be even sitting here and talking to me like this?
I'll probably be doing some desk job.
Desk job.
It depends on, because I haven't.
It's the 60s. I think you were in the kitchen.
Yes.
Why would you mention the kitchen, though? Well, no, that was so misogynistic.
It was the 60s. I did not create history, ladies and gentlemen.
But in the 60s, I think, women used to have jobs. I mean, especially in Kuwait, women in the 60s had really good jobs as teachers. And
I don't know how to answer that question, honestly.
But
I know.
I haven't seen TV in the 60s. I was born in the 90s. So.
You haven't seen TVs in the 60s. You should have. But let me turn to you and ask you a question. Okay. I want to ask you, if there's a theme song, or if you will, soundtrack for your life, what would that be?
I want that question.
Okay, you answer it, because I have to think about this.
Question. Let him take the question.
Thunder. Easy.
Thunderstruck by AC/DC?
Sure, that's exactly what I meant.
Of course, that's what you meant. Okay, well, we're not. Is that what he meant, really? Okay, thunder. The sound of thunder is actually, yes.
The sound of thunder. I like hearing it.
Right.
The sound of thunder.
For me, for you, what it would be? A soundtrack of your life.
I don't know. My life is...
Your life. You know who you are, right? What is the soundtrack of... You, if you
why
want to
does
say,
that feel like
me.
I'm being?
I have a deep answer with that thunder song, but yeah, keep going.
Okay.
No, you answer that. I still have to think. Like my life is, I don't know. Like my life is.
Which song?
Which song is your
which
life?
Song?
Exactly.
Song.
Which song is your
I
life?
I listen to all kinds of music, so I don't know if I can't pick one. I listen to English music, Arabic music,
right.
I listen to Indian music. So
maybe men are more decisive than women?
No, women take their time. Listen, I have. Don't get into this territory. It's very.
Yeah, don't get there.
Don't get into this territory.
Don't get there.
You
don't.
Went enough with the kitchen, though.
Exactly. But going back to the subject of the, I'm going to flip this really quickly, but since we mentioned the kitchen.
Do I need to make a sandwich here?
Who guys do you think is the most successful?
Chef?
It's the man. That's the man.
Thank you.
Yes.
So unfortunately.
Yeah, you should be in the kitchen.
We are
me.
The one who should be in the kitchen. There we go.
I do enjoy cooking.
Now you can clap if you want to. But yes, we are the men. We should be in the kitchen
because
we know how to cook.
We do know how to cook.
Yeah.
Yes, we do.
Make
yes.
me a sandwich.
But going back to the radio subject.
You owe me basbousas still. But anyway.
I'm in on that if you want.
I want to go back to the radio world. How do you see streaming affecting the radio world? Everything is now stream this song, stream this podcast, stream this radio show. What
right.
is, are you, are we losing fan base or, I mean, listeners in the radio in the age of the internet?
Unfortunately, we cannot stop the
evolution.
You know, the hands of time or the technology. Things are going to keep moving forward
right.
from now on, just like it did back in the day in the World War II, and after that, after that. And now we are working on AI
right.
to be independent, you know, and to actually develop
replace
AI.
Replace us.
Or that.
I mean, you have a show where you replace...
I mean, I something. Do have a show where I actually interact with AI.
Yep.
But the question, I guess, is I think... Or a statement. I think just like everything advances, I think radio will advance as well.
It has adapted, I think, to the trends.
It will. I mean, with time, it wouldn't be your classical radio environment.
Are we talking about Kuwait radio? Or are we talking about in general? Okay. Because if we're talking about in general, radio has to be there no matter what happens in the world. It is our, you know, fallback plan. no matter what happens.
When the internet goes out, you can still listen to the radio.
If something goes out, the radio
is always there. Who has radios? Who has traditional radios in their homes nowadays?
What happens in the movies when you...
You have to go to the market and get one just in case for emergencies.
Like, here's the thing. What's a perfect comedy action scene for you when you watch an action shooting vehicle moving fast and there is an elevator song running in the radio or a song by UB40, like, you know, one of those old songs, and they are shooting out of the vehicle. The radio is making that funny scene.
True.
So one of the points is that radio will always be in our minds and in our lives,
so
no matter
fallback,
what.
I would say.
It's definitely a fallback, you know, strategy. If God forbid AI does what it does, which I suggest for you to read a book called Scary Smart, released
Scary
by
Scary Smart.
Yeah.
Or just watch iRobot. Same thing.
But or, or Terminator.
Terminator.
I just seen a movie. I forgot what it was called. It's a new movie about, you know, robots being smart and emotional, and they become
Black Mirror.
No, it's a movie. It's not a show.
All right.
I forgot. I'll check it out later.
Oh,
later.
You're talking about Megan.
Megan is a doll.
It's like Chucky.
Megan is
amazing. Megan is a robot. It's a movie about where robots are, like, you know, more emotional. They're interactive and they cry and they have babies and it's insane.
Oh, that's a different movie. That's a whole different movie. No, I can't remember
Since
that one.
We're talking about shows, I wanted to mention again ChatGPT 2.
Yeah,
you're doing fun things with it, but how's the experience just dealing with an AI?
I'm
in
not
your
really
head.
Talking
in
to
your
him,
head.
And it's in my
I
head.
You're, it's in your
yeah,
head.
It's like a karma. Mm-hmm, like you're basically
but
talking
you
to yourself.
Do you think it's fun doing something like that?
It is fun. I like doing something different. I like experimenting.
Wouldn't you rather have an actual co-host than
I have
an artificial
one right now?
One?
And he's a misogynistic
person. What's the difference? What's the difference between him?
One thing that I'm not.
What's the difference between him and the AI?
Oh yeah.
Because I'm interacting. Right now, I'm interacting with my co-host. I'm laughing. You get these feelings, emotions. But once you are interacting with AI, you're just stone cold sitting there and like, yeah, AI. Tell me more about whatever you're doing. And then you basically have to pretend that you're talking to someone. It's basically play pretend game.
And so are you telling me that if they added consciousness to the AI, which is...
It would be scary.
Feelings
scary.
That you're saying.
That would be scary.
It's going to happen eventually. So if that happens...
But I don't think
there'll
be real
happens,
feelings. Stimulated feelings. It's simulated.
Well,
it's not going
to
be...
I'm going to go to the question of define real.
Real is what humans feel. It becomes from the brain, like whatever chemistry that we have in the brain, whatever experiences that we have in life, you know, growing up in different environments that affects us growing up. But when we talk about
some certain things in life are real to you that are not real to me, and vice versa.
I know, but it's still real,
right?
Because I grew with these experiences. I live, I die, I'm a human. But with AI, it's
let's see
just
what he was trying to go with that question.
Basically, what I'm trying to say is that the statistics show that more than 30% or more than 35% of one of the biggest franchises in the United States, and this franchise is a food company.
Okay.
We all know it. Mm-hmm. But this company laid off more than 35% of its employees.
Because of automation.
Because of automations and AI. You don't need humans anymore. All you have to do is just
didn't that happen before when they started inventing machines and they started inventing?
Yeah, but now it's going to take even more jobs.
Yeah, that's
you know,
what I'm
banks
saying.
Banks won't have employees.
That's like happened before and it's happening
that
again. So we're just talking about technology, you know, doing jobs, but we're not talking about actual feelings growing up, you know, making families. It's different. So I don't think
you don't see it evolving into
I think it's going to eventually, not into a consciousness, come on. I mean,
you need to watch more sci-fi.
I do, that's the thing.
Because, let me just break it down for you, it actually can develop consciousness.
How, though?
Here's a quick
information.
Good
theories?
Not theories, okay. Actual.
He's like iRobot.
No, actually, the ex-CEO of a very big company, an internet company, he was assigned to a project that he was managing AI experimenting, and the AI was supposed to pick one item from a big circle, like a square, a circle or something, and the AI failed to pick any of them. After 2 weeks, the AI started to pick one, and the rest of the AIs failed to pick that item. 2 days later, the rest of the AIs picked up the same item.
They learned,
yes,
basically. But again, to create the AI, you need humans. No. Are we going to reach to a point where AI make themselves?
Well, the interesting part is that actually the code was not changed. Humans did not interact. Humans did not change anything. AI just educated itself.
Educate, but can they make themselves? Can they create themselves?
Well, if you integrate that with our jobs, they can definitely replace me in any moment. Not to mention that now there are AI lawyers.
AI effective. Lawyers.
Yes, effectively, by the way.
Okay.
Something well, I want to look into tonight on YouTube.
You might want to have a lawyer yeah. as an AI, and it's true. It is actually effective, and it's very soon going to be approved by the FDA, because Elon Musk got the approval from the FDA to start experimenting.
Elon Musk has chips. He's experimenting too.
So what is the best part about presenting when it comes to TV, radio, whatever? Presenting is, the thing is, when people think of TV presenter, they think we're out there because we want to get famous. We want our pictures to be, you know, everywhere. But I think it's more of it's something in you once you're, like, talking to your audience, once you're on camera or on the radio. What makes it special, and how does it feel? Like, how is it rewarding to you?
I want to say about presenters, when you mentioned the word presenters, there's two different categories. There are the presenter that has the script ready to go for you to just say it, repeat the words, go home, repeat.
Yeah, that's not my thing.
This is one thing. Yeah. The other presenter that when you're trying to talk to is basically the host mm-hmm. or the person who is here for a reason.
Interactive
with the audience. Mm-hmm. I'm here to say something for the person who is either listening or seeing. Mm. And that reason is for you to decide, what do you want to leave your audience with? Do you want to leave them with a new message? Do you want to leave them with an informative message? Do you want to be an actual influencer? Not like the ones we're seeing nowadays. Do you want...
yes, not like the ones we see nowadays? Yep.
Those.
Are you looking at me?
Okay. No, because you had that, you know, that yeah. smile yes. on your face. Uh-huh.
Okay. So basically, you need to think about the message that you want to leave and open the subject that you want to leave your audience with. Happy, positive, and looking forward for the next day.
All right, thank you for being this. I think we need a part two, three,
yeah,
four out of
this. Yeah, this was a fun chat.
This is fun.
This is amazing. I would love to try radio on your show.
Yeah, by all means.
Yeah, I want to do that.
One for one.
Hey, right. Take me. Don't forget me.
Yeah.
Anyway, we'd love to have you again. Thank you for being with us.
What is the name of the show that you do? Sorry.
My show is called The Weekender.
The Weekender.
The Weekender.
Weekends.
Hence, it's Thursday and Friday.
Thursday and Friday.
From 7 till 9 p.m.
Okay. Nice.
Yes. And usually I pick up topics that is interesting for the listeners. Mm-hmm. Something fresh, light. And at the same time, the music playlist, I usually pick up something away from the Billboard charts.
Okay.
Right. Cool.
Perfect.
Well, tune in to 99.7. Check out Noor Nejdi. And we'll be back for the wrap-up. What a fun episode. Time flew by, honestly.
Yeah,
we talked of so many different subjects. Music, radio, zombies, AI.
Zombies.
Kitchen.
You really think you could survive a zombie apocalypse just because you play a few video games? Trust me, you're not going to be hitting buttons.
I didn't make that claim. He did.
Okay.
I was just joking.
Okay.
And when we are in a zombie apocalypse, I'll just be in a bunker. Just be a
Do
bunker.
Do you have a bunker? Why?
Oh, you don't have a bunker?
I don't have a bunker.
Come on, the apocalypse is coming. You should have a bunker.
I don't believe there's an apocalypse coming anytime soon.
All right, let's wrap it up here. We'll see you in the next episode with a brand new guest and more stories to share right here on The Untold.
Good night.
Good night.